can you go around troubling people all your life? You can't do that and expect nothing to come back to you.
It wasn't a riot. It was a civil war. The people then feel that they have no choice but to fight.
We've got a right to do what we want, right? Everybody's got a right to have some sort of enjoyment in life, right? And as you well know from coming from the East End, right, you don't get no enjoyment from going in a factory and working all day long and living in slums, right?
But I feel that it is difficult to get people to unite, because each man, or woman for that matter, feels that so long as his or her front path and garden is okay, everything's all right with the world.
We'll have a future only if we organise and if we get a voice.
To Trafalgar Square, from there down Whitehall, and then to Hyde Park Corner.
In the last few days, I have become so angered by the attitude of some people in the British Parliament towards the so-called foreign scum that the whole thing has taken on a different colouring for me.
Violence in our society is hidden because people are conditioned to it. It's only by violence that you can get somebody to go and work in a factory for 8 hours a day doing a job which is absolutely meaningless to him. He knows that if he doesn't do the job, he'll starve or be pushed around in life, and he sees no alternative.
Well, I think that going to the square frustrates the movement rather than helps it, because it shows that here you are in front of the square having a general punch-up with the police, and it's got nothing to do with what you're protesting about.
People have been talking about how you can't organise a demonstration if it's a militant demonstration. You must let it take its course. One of the most common phrases that came up in the ad hoc committee was, "It will happen anyway." But there is another sort of control, the self-control of the people within the society, based on their knowledge of what they're doing, why they're doing it.
Take the struggle beyond the stage of protest. We've actually got to begin to change the environment in which we exist.
The questions that people who have a revolutionary perspective will be asking are, what happened this Sunday to bring us closer to a different form of activity? We'll have to come up with good answers for next time, because it simply cannot be true that one demonstration leads to another demonstration and that demonstration will somehow qualitatively change into becoming the revolutionary movement. We have to think now how our activity will bring about the change.
This is the voice of Lewisham people. We've come here today to show what the ordinary, decent, reasonable citizens of Lewisham think about their borough being turned into a battleground by the fascists and by the National Front.
The National Front's activities organiser recently said, "Where we are strong, we are putting a lot of psychological pressure on immigrants. We are telling them we do not feel they should be here." And he added, "Yes, we are a racialist party, and we are respectabilizing racialism."
White people actually believe that the few black people who live in an area like this are responsible for the deprivation and the lack of facilities and the poor housing in the area, because they've been fed with it over a long period of time.
I've been fighting racism for 20 years. It's the most boring in its manifestations. It grows where there's unemployment, it grows where there's ignorance, and just as Hitler used the Jews as a scapegoat to blame all the ills of Germany onto them, so people in the National Front and the National Party are trying to do the same. We reject it as bogus lies.
When they were just standing there, nothing was happening, you know. I mean, we were just standing there waiting to see what the front were going to do, and the police were just standing there. And it was always the police, by attempting to push people one way or the other, and, you know, that started any kind of violence that may have happened, you know.
They was just kicking out and everything. Some people were saying, no, I don't think the police would do that. But they did, they just came in.
Let him go! This is our borough! Don't let him alone! Leave him alone!
What's your name?
And that's why a lot of people got aggressive towards the end. Because they had had enough of the police running round, whacking this person and whacking that person, especially if they hadn't done anything.
Police were just trying to break up all the other groups.
Yeah.
You know, trying to scatter all the other groups and just guard the National Front. Now, why couldn't it be the other way around? Because the people who they were scattering belonged in that area.
Before we start the meeting, we have a debt of gratitude to pay to the police today. As we usually do, I want you to show your appreciation for the unfortunate police who've had this problem today by giving them the only thing we can give them here now, three rousing cheers for the police. Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
Hooray!
They can come with plastic bullets, they can come with water cannons, they can come with the real cannons, they can come with nuclear. Bob Marley said, have no fear, because the time has to come.
The youths of Eglinton won't put down their Remington.
On the 12th of January 1983, my brother Colin Roach was found dead in the foyer of Stoke Newington Police Station.
The truth is there, but it's hiding. And everything being done by the police, the coroners, and we the parents, we can't do nothing. Our solicitor can't do nothing, really, because they arrange everything.
They killed him. Look at it. Just look at it. You think anybody for going there and killing someone? Bollocks. It's a load of shit they're talking about. You come to march up front.
Yeah, man. What do we want?
Jobs!
We want kids. What do we want?
Jobs!
We don't want land. What don't we want?
Jobs!
All the time, every time we have a march, the police all the time break it up. They feel like they must arrest somebody every time the marches is up.
When a policeman comes and comes into your house, right, and it leads eventually to the death of a person, who do you put trust in the system now to say, well, a wrong has been done and who's going to right that wrong?
We want some justice. He's got a record for harassment. Come on, denying.
Youths took a decision that they would have a peaceful demonstration, and I must emphasize the word peaceful demonstration outside the Tottenham police station. But when they were about to go, they were prevented from doing so by the blockading of Willing Road by the police, three van loads of police. This is not fiction, this is fact. I was there.
And when I went to the station, they kept saying to me, it's your bastard's birthday tomorrow. How do you feel it's your bastard's birthday?
The Tottenham police are in a state of vendetta. What they are trying to do, apart from to intimidate and to terrify for future conduct, is they're trying to gather evidence. And the technique in Tottenham at the moment is to hope that if you terrify enough youngsters, you will in due course acquire enough convictions of other black youngsters at the hands of those that you've arrested and terrified.
We will not bow down to a high racism. Yeah. We will not bow down to injustice. We will not bow down to exploitation. What you gonna do?
I'm gonna stand.
I just can't tolerate racism. just can't tolerate injustice. I just won't tolerate exploitation. What you gonna do?
People also stress the parallel between oppression here and racist South Africa. Mrs. Thatcher invited P.W. Botha, head of the racist South African regime, to Britain, highlighting the concrete links between Britain and the whites who hold black South Africans in their grip. Mrs. Thatcher recently made it clear that in her battle with the Soviet Union, the racist rulers of South Africa are valued allies. South Africa's resources are necessary, and the Africans are of little account.
The policing that was done in third world countries, whether it's in the Caribbean or in the Indian subcontinent or in Southeast Asia, the colonial police force always was oppressive and repressive. The so-called friendly Bobby existed only in Britain, right, and existed only during the colonial period when the British society could afford to keep a certain level of prosperity going by exploiting third world peoples. But as Malcolm X said in another context, the chickens came home to roost the moment the empire ceased to exist because of our struggles against colonialism.
The myth is that the empire and the trade developed for good reasons, but all sorts of positive reasons. I remember reading or being told when I learned history that the empire had happened sort of by mischance. We just happened to go to India for trade and India was weak, and so, well, we just sort of took over India because we could do it better than the Indians who were governing the country. So there's an inability to recognise the real forces at work because people believe all sorts of myths about moral superiority in taking civilisation.
They had to convince themselves that people weren't people in order to be able to treat them as vilely as they did, because you couldn't do that to an equal. So the only way you can do it is to make that person something less than human.
Before everyone was going on about black people, we said it was the Irish in Deptford that got all the stick. It's always someone, you know.
And I think it means that people are really rather afraid that this country might be rather swamped by people with a different culture. And you know, the British character has done so much for democracy, for law,
and done so much throughout the world, that if there is a fear that it might be swamped, people are going to react and be rather hostile to those coming in.
But it's only if you use that kind of generality and that kind of, you know, labelling and dehumanising that you can then use those kind of words, and then that helps you then to introduce the kind of policies.
It was necessary because they all couldn't exist in the little houses and the patches of land that they had in Mona and Leitrim, west of Ireland, Cavan.
The forces that created the mass influx of Irish women and men into Britain in the 1950s lie in the history of the colonial relationship between the two countries. As its nearest colony, Ireland was traditionally Britain's larder. Its economy was geared towards providing food and livestock to feed Britain's growing urban and industrial population. After the Second World War and during the 1950s, Britain began a program of restructuring its war-torn economy. Industry was modernized, the welfare state was set up, and a vast program of house building was initiated. To achieve this, additional labor was required.
We have contributed to building this country after it was broken by the war.
I've always felt that what was, as I said, Ireland's loss in those days was England's gain.
At times I was very hurt because I worked so very hard, put in such very long hours. The pay I got was actually pocket money. And then if a patient or a woman on a bus would refer to me as an Irish pig, That I found that very hurtful. The English had to believe that we Irish were something less than human, that we were stupider than they were, that we were expendable or disposable. Because if they really faced up to the fact that we were just as human, or maybe just as bright as they were, they wouldn't have tolerated us.
If I went back home to Ireland now, I'd be to my grandchildren as I was to my mother, once a year visitor. And I wouldn't want that.
We've lived apart from the society, we've deluded ourselves that we are going someplace, that we're in transit. We're not.
The important thing for me about Irish culture and music would be that it gives me a sense of my roots and gives me a sense of a history and a tradition that I belong to.
And the enjoyment of being with young and old and all different mixtures of people who all seem to enjoy the same thing, and the closeness. There's no sort of prejudice towards anyone. If you play music, you're accepted, and I think that's what I like most.
Have courted six, and you might have courted seven, you might have courted eight, nine, ten, or 11, you might.
The re-emergence of the conflict in Northern Ireland in 1968 had a major impact on Irish people in this country. Our cultural and political traditions were once again under attack.
Not rotten, although I'm forsaken.
It made me realize that you had to make a decision to be English or Irish, that there was no middle ground.
Soon be forgotten, then so neatly, bonny laddie, I'll gang by you.
As the war in the north escalated, the conflict was increasingly represented in the British media by images of violence and destruction, with little attempt being made to look at the historical and political background to the situation. And once again, these images are used to justify Britain's civilizing role in Ireland. In the early 1970s, sections of the Irish community in this country organized political protests in response to the events in Northern Ireland.
It's also been known that as a result of that, perfectly innocent people have been taken off to jail and held for 7 days without their families knowing where they are. People are scared of that. So obviously they take precautions.
So I think, like, we avoided being white by being Irish and having Britain as, you know, as a historical enemy kind of that was shared.
Things that are said and that happen to black people raise echoes in my mind of things that in some cases happen to me, in some cases they're things that my parents and their family have talked about.
I remember my father saying to me, and I felt it very powerfully, how in the East End where he was brought up, there were two schools. There was the Jewish school and there was the Catholic school. And when he'd go to school, some of the Catholic kids would grab hold of him and other Jewish kids and rub pig's fat into his face as a sign of derision.
But I also realise, I think at times the irony is that the oppressed of yesterday can become the oppressors of today.
I think a lot of English people are still very anti-Semitic, but it forced me to realise that as a white person, as opposed to being a black person or a person of colour, I was very privileged, and I don't experience that level of oppression nor of racism.
One thing that I've found difficult and constantly have to try and practice is challenging those small, tiny incidents that happen. I was on a bus recently, and a woman got on and said she was passed out in the queue by
to black people. I think they queue jumped. Yeah. Now she did that thing about generalizing and labeling, and instead of being cross with two people, she made some comment about the entire black population of the world, you know, and they're always at it, or they're always, they always push the. So I found, I just said that day, I said, there's plenty of white people would do it too. She said, funny, isn't it? I never meet them. I said, well, you haven't been on the 36th bus at 4 o'clock in the afternoon when they come out of school or something like that. As soon as I say a small thing like that, lots of other people will nod as if you've helped them to at least register that they're not caught up in the. If you keep silent, everybody white will assume that everybody's in agreement with that woman.
And I was also aware fairly soon that lots of the people who hated me hated other sorts of groups as well. And you often work on the basis that, you know, the enemies of my enemies are therefore my friends.
That's my ache and brain, my pounding in the hay. My freedom, my prison cell, my tempting to destroy. My fantasies, my lost control, my confusion, dissolution. My casemate, my manhood, my wanting just to scream. My screaming, my screaming, my wanting just to scream.
I remember when I was about 8 running around someone screaming, homo, homo, and I didn't know what it meant, but yeah. I mean, they're there, those things.
That's right.
And you don't think about it, and I didn't.
It's the whole, yes, I mean if that, yeah, that's what it should be taught from like a very early age.
Children who need to be taught to respect traditional moral values are being taught that they have an inalienable right to be gay.
He's in the studio at the moment. I'm afraid that we have rather been invaded by some people who we hope to be removing very shortly.
Think about rights for lesbian and gay people.
Do you have any daughters?
Yeah, 3.
What would you think if you found out that they were lesbian?
Well, I think I'd be too pleased, really.
Why not?
I don't know, really. It's just that, not the damn thing, is it?
She didn't want to accept it, and she didn't for ages and ages until I sort of said to her face to face, sort of thing, and I really wanted her to understand it, but I don't think she will. It makes me quite sad in a way.
The most I spoke about with my dad was about his job and, like, say, was it still secure, and nothing at all gay cropped up, and there was no way that he was going to answer me. I don't really know anything about my dad. I never sort of talked to my dad much. I used to communicate with him.
What would you do for your daughter? If it turned up when she got a bit older, she found out she was a lesbian and told you?
I'd stand by her.
Yeah, you would?
Yes, definitely.
That's a very unusual attitude from a parent.
Yeah. I mean, well, like, it doesn't matter what she turns out like, I'm still her mother.
Are you proud to say
it? I don't have my face, I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, I'm proud to say it because it's just what I am.
Don't come too near me.
No, I'm not going to do anything.
Tell her.
What? I said, I'm not going to do it. What did you think I was going to do?
I don't know what you're going to do. Touch me up because you're a lesbian, ain't it? It's obvious.
I'm sure a man can give a lady more sexual pleasure than a lady can give a lady.
Well, do you think all lesbians have ever slept with men? I mean, do you think lesbians are women that don't sleep with men ever?
No, I don't think that.
Because, I mean, I've slept with lots of men.
Oh, can I ask you something then? So out of the men and the women you've slept with, you find that the women give you more sexual pleasure than the men do?
Yeah.
Statistics are often quoted that 10% of the population are lesbian and gay, and I think the reality is that most of the population at some time in their lives have had feelings of closeness, affection, intimacy with someone of the same sex.
I started to come out, I had to question the morals and the ideas that society had put there for me to follow, okay? Idea, what they wanted me to be was a little straight boy, getting married, settling down, having kids, a mortgage, semi-detached, a dog in suburbia. And that's what I should be. So when I started to realise that that's not what I'm going to be, you know, that's not what I am, I'm gay, it's as valid as being straight.
I started to question other things. I started to say, well, you know, if that's what they say about sexuality, then what about the rest of life, you know? And I started to see that basically the whole country is not geared for the people. It's geared for the few people who are making money out of it.
I think if you're talking about liberation, I think I'd ultimately like to see the day come when you didn't have to have these divisions between people, you know, that sort of one person is straight and another is gay, or, you know, one person is a man and another person is a woman. I think those divisions are really played on, and I think they're fairly false. But, I mean, until that happens, I think we need some kind of equality, at least, just to, and the freedom to be ourselves.
When I go halfway up the streets, I know some four lads stand by the corner. They usually say every morning on my way to work, and they always used to shout after me, call me names. And I thought to myself, well, when I get round the corner, I'll be on. Before I got round the corner, one of them shouted, there's a queer bastard, let's get him. So they started running and I started running, but they caught up with me and they dragged me down an entry. Two of them held me down while two of them ripped my shirt off my pants and things, and two of them started playing Norton Crosses on my body with a razor blade, and two of them started pissing and spitting all over me, and then they just ran off and left me.
I fell on the floor again where he kept laying into me. He was just kicking and kicking my head until I was kicked unconscious, and I ended up in Guy's Hospital.
Did the police follow it up?
No, police took him away and released him the next morning, and that was it.
All the time people sort of tell you, if you ever get jumped on, lie back and take it because it's much safer. And suddenly she's saying, well, don't lie back and take it because you're perfectly capable of protecting yourself. And you think, OK, well, in a few weeks' time, I will be able to do that.
It's your right not to be worried about going home alone at night. You've got a right to be out there when it's dark as much as anybody else.
It's not all based on strength, therefore you've got an advantage because they don't expect it.
My body belongs to me. You got that? My body belongs to me. You got that? My body belongs to me. I am a woman and I want to stay free.
I do talk about it,
aren't you? Oh, yeah, well, you hide, don't you? Pretend it doesn't happen.
What always amazes me, and I still think about it yet, is at the time, I worried more about people knowing that he was doing it. Not actually because I was getting battered, no. But I didn't want people to know that he was battering me.
That's right.
I mean, on the way to the hospital, you say, don't tell them you did it, don't tell them you did it. Well, you should have said, you're not going to tell them you did it.
Things you tell your friends that you'd never dream of telling your husband. I mean, like, sexual problems. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't tell your husband because you'd be afraid of hurting him.
Yeah.
Or you're making him feel inadequate. Yeah. So you go and tell your friend, and then your friend will say, well, that's funny because so-and-so and so-and-so. And you think to yourself, well, she's got a problem as well. We've all got problems.
Yeah.
And your problem's halved.
Waiting at the clinic. Oh. Waiting at the clinic. Waiting at the clinic. Waiting at the clinic so long. Why am I waiting? Waiting so long. We're at the clinic, been here 1 hour. What is going on? Oh, 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 oh. We're at the clinic, we're at the clinic. Ooh, ooh, we're at the clinic, we're at the clinic.
When was my last period? Are your periods regular?
Well, no, they're not. Ooh, I'm nervous. I'm really nervous. Ooh, 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 I'm nervous. I'm really nervous.
Oh, 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 feeling guilty, feeling guilty. Feeling guilty, feeling guilty.
They'll say it's my fault.
Why weren't you on the pill? You should be ashamed of yourself.
Oh, I'm feeling ill. We're at the clinic, we're at the clinic. Ooh, we're at the clinic, we're at the clinic. We're at the clinic.
I think a lot of people do get married for the sole purpose of having children, which is pretty pointless, really. You know, I wouldn't marry just because I was pregnant.
Why are you getting married then, if everything's so...
I just want some security in life.
I think a man should supply this to women, to you?
Well, I think so. I think if two people love each other, they get married.
Marrying. Everybody seems to think marrying. To me, marrying isn't that bit of paper. It's the life that you lead together. That is your marriage, what you do together, you sleep together, you have children. Just that few words in a registry office and a bit of paper, that's not marriage.
I hear that divorce at least once a week put up as an argument in support of the nuclear family.
Sure.
They're not an example of anything, and they were based on very bourgeois notions of work and non-work, and based on very old-fashioned ideas of what a mother was. She was someone who produced children like objects, put them in a creche, and then went off to produce yet other objects.
I am a person.
Yes.
I am an individual. I have my own feelings. I have things I want to do.
Mm.
I am not a slave. I wasn't put here just for you.
This meeting is the first of its kind. It's very important for women to get a feeling of being able to talk to each other.
It's a very good feeling.
There's
so many women are concerned, and they seem to be thinking quite hard about their problems.
Specific biological situation of the continuing relationship of the child to his biological mother and its need for care by human beings are being hopelessly confused in the growing insistence that child and biological mother must never be separated. This is a new and subtle form of anti-feminism in which men, under the guise of exalting the importance of maternity, are typing women more tightly to their children than has been thought necessary since the invention of bottle feeding and baby carriages.
Some men have still got the idea of the Victorian era, like, you know, I mean, where they come home drunk and bash your back, you're only there so you're only good enough to have children and get married. Well, this is all changing over the years.
Equality!
What do we want?
No street now!
What do we want?
Equal education!
Well, I think the Women's League shouldn't really be only about equal pay. It should be about the way someone like myself talks to a woman at a party or at home, how I treated my wife, how I treated my sisters, and that kind of very subtle discrimination that's possible even to someone who imagines that he's very liberal.
The only way we can keep ourselves from getting airy, fairy and ethereal and talking about isms and ites and eights and all the rest of it, we just get completely lost. I don't feel a person if I just talk. I mean, I know capitalism exists, but if I only talk about capitalism and not about us who are exploited, we'll never get anywhere.
I think you've achieved a fantastic amount for the women of this country. For solidarity, just that they know that everybody else feels like that and they don't have to be scared any longer.
Well, I think that the process of everybody's becoming more liberated and looking for their own freedom is very important. I think the idea that the conflict is between men and women, I first was very sympathetic to that, but now I'm not so sure. Men are pretty repressed too.
I would like to emphasise that no one has ever done any research into father deprivation, and it's about time we have some research done into what happens when children are parted from their fathers for a long time.
We have got to struggle for our liberation and the liberation of men and women and children. But we've also, as parents, got to struggle for the liberation of our children from us. This is very, very important, because in our society, children are possessions.
Do you ever buy anything that's not designer?
Oh, I do, yes.
Yeah, I think the future may well be taking us full circle, in the sense that something like daytime lifestyle programming for women is going back, in a way, to the 40s and 50s, where women's programming was in the afternoon. It was to do with lifestyle rather than economic and political issues.
Many of today's magazines have created some kind of ideal woman. She's really beautiful and she's got nice long legs and she's sort of well made up and everything. But I don't really think that sort of woman's believable, because to actually look that good would cost a lot of money and would also take a lot of time. And so, like, you were a parent, let's say a single parent, there'd be more important things coming first, like looking after your kids and buying food for them.
The estates, and since they've shut down the single, the special letting scheme in most local councils, has made the situation even worse.
Finding childcare is a real problem now, because there's no spaces anywhere, like in nurseries. And another option is childminders, but they cost too much. And if you do get help from, like, the social services, you can never tell how long they're going to, like, give you help, and how long you'll have to wait before you do get help. So in some ways it's like a vicious circle.
It's quite common to hear people saying, I'm just a mother, as though that's no sort of job at all. And we have little status, sometimes low self-esteem. And I don't think a lot of people don't think they're doing anything of any worth.
People place much more stress on income-related jobs rather than anything to do with housework or work at home, bringing up children or anything like that.
The local state nursery, which I'd sent the first child to, consisted of a 2.5 hour session a day. Well, I mean, that's fine for the children, but it's no good for a mother who wants to go out to work.
Obviously, there are a lot of women at work. There isn't any nursery care whatsoever laid on by most employers, even ones who are so working for the council, you know, are supposed to be well catered for as regards equal opportunities. Very few places do seem to provide nursery care of any sort.
The problems increase because you have a childminder and you're coming home from a job not to relax but to start another full-time job. And there's also the guilt that comes into it. You worry that your child isn't perhaps being adequately stimulated, that you're not spending enough time with them.
When she was about a year, I realised that in fact it wasn't enough just to be at home, that one does fade into some sort of insignificance. Your brain isn't functioning, it stultifies.
I was at home with a baby and a 2-year-old boy, and I felt winter was coming on. I felt very lonely and isolated in that situation.
I feel guilty sometimes about the feelings I have towards my kids.
So do I.
Sure,
I feel
it's all this rubbish that you read in the media when you see this woman washing up, why is your hand so soft, mummy?
Yes.
You think, now why can't I answer my kids like that?
Childcare is a very personal activity, and we all do it differently, and we have to learn to accept that and really listen to each other. I find it a really revealing process.
I used to teach nurses, and while I got on well with them personally, I really disliked their method of training, which concentrated on their role as authority figures, and I wanted to have my child in the kind of daycare that gave him a lot more freedom of choice.
I feel that really the priorities with kids is to learn how to choose for themselves, to have the opportunity to choose for themselves without impinging upon the freedom of other kids having this opportunity.
The article quoted a Tory councillor who said, how can 2-year-olds be racist and sexist? Which misses the point about all the images that children are fed about, like ideal families, like middle class, two parents, always white, you know.
At the centre we try to encourage girls to be more adventurous and boys to be more gentle.
As far as Victoria's concerned, I didn't mind at all the fact that she was encouraged to break down the sex roles. She'll never be made to feel inferior to a man, and I'm sure that after nearly 2 years she had at the centre, I'm sure this has made a tremendous difference to her life and always will.
We've always encouraged the kids at the centre to be self-reliant and to help in activities such as food preparation, which are basically communal activities, encouraging them to be sensitive to their needs and the needs of others.
We set the puppet show and we all took turns. And first I was it and I said, once upon a time, there was a man called Charlie Chaplin, and he bought some roller skates, right? And then
the thing that's most obvious to me is the way the kids relate to each other. They've got very close relationships, which are in a kind of way like brother and sister relationships. Maybe one of the reasons for that is because the kids don't feel as if they've got to compete for affection, which is the sort of thing that they have to do at school. You know, they have to get things right in order to be praised. Whereas at the centre, they get praised or cuddled, not because they've been good in the accepted sense, but just because they might need to be told that they're great and they might need to be cuddled.
Obviously prefer to be funded by our local council as a recognition of childcare in the borough, but failing that, we then turn to the GLC, and that's where we got the funding.
We should make very sure that we keep reminding them that this isn't anything like enough, you know, that, like, this is only revealed to us what the real nature of the problem is, and that we've learnt a lot from doing this, but it's, you know, it's sort of
a drop in the ocean, really.
Do you feel there's a big need for a play site in this area?
Yes, I do. Litlands like this, they've got nowhere to play.
It seems that the priority is for the lorries and not for the residents.
Not for the
queue,
that's right.
That's it, you know, I intend doing something. It's time anyway. I mean, I've got 3 petitions down here in the last 6 years and nothing's happened, you know. It's just more kids getting run over.
Do you know what one council fella said to me today? We can't afford a zebra crossing. I said to him, we don't want a gold one, we just want black and white with 2 Belisha beacons.
You sit across this end, sit across there, you block them in Riverton, you block them in Dalton, and you block them on Bedford Hill. They can't divert them because they can't go through people's gardens. Okay? Yeah. Right.
But do you like sitting in the middle of the road?
Yes!
Why do you like sitting?
So the cars can't go past.
Yeah,
why do you want to stop the cars going past?
Because there are too many people getting run over.
Why not speak at once?
Too many people getting run over.
What worries me, you know that playground ground down there, well, they call it a playground. There's nothing in it. So therefore, you see all these bricks and this side in here, the kids are going to think, oh, I'll have a good time on that. And one of them is going to really get hurt someday.
It just needs a group of people to start getting it together.
Why didn't you just get together a pressure group on the council and get them to do something about it?
Doesn't do any good. No, doesn't do any good at all.
You've tried this?
Yes, yes.
Together, as the Tallaker Action Group, we set out to clear the Tallaker Road site, a derelict site used for years as a rubbish tip, and run a play programme on it for the 6-week holiday.
Give the kids a focus for their own kinds of ideas to evolve, allowing the kids to be spontaneous within that framework.
In a couple of weeks, the site became the focal point for kids in the area. More young adults and parents started to become involved in the activities.
We proved to them, this has been our job initially, that we can run this site and this site can work as a play site for children, and that not everything has to be destroyed.
Within 2 weeks of the site closing and returning to the council, the huts and the dinosaur, no longer protected by the kids who had built it, were completely destroyed.
To us, it's a community thing which should be run entirely by the community, which they just do not seem to want to do. They don't want it to be a local participation at all. They want it to be council run.
I feel although there are a lot of houses being built up here, I feel there is little for young children and youngsters to do. And that's why there are a lot of crimes going around in this area.
The children on this estate that truant and do things that they shouldn't do, they're doing it because they think that society is against them and it's their way of hitting back. You see, they just don't get a fair deal anywhere. Wherever they go, they're known as the little bastards from the Canadian estate, and nobody will entertain them, nobody wants them.
On Marius Road, it's an old sort of snooker place. It's been empty for about, well, at least 3 years, to my certain knowledge. And it's really in a bad state now. I mean, all the windows are broken, the ceiling's leaking. You know, it's just really mucky, and nobody seems to be doing anything with it. And as everybody here knows, there's a hell of a need for, you know, places for youth clubs, discos. I mean, it just seems criminal that a place like that, when there is nowhere else at all in Ballon, is standing empty for whatever reason. And I mean, maybe we might have to go to lengths of taking it over, you know? Just physically breaking into the building like we did on the playground to make people look at it and think about the issue.
People who are off school, not getting any education, not just anybody, but people who've not been off school, who've not been receiving any education for two and 3 years. So plainly the Education Authority is not been able to do anything about it. Now, we've plainly been able to do something about it. We set up in a club. This place was paid for out of taxation. So in theory, it's owned by the people. In practice, it's owned by the Education Authority, who can decide how it's used. Everybody here, including the person in charge of the building, is for the project, but we've just got these phone calls to say that we can't work here, because apparently if you try and do something, they come down on you like a ton of bricks and say that you can't do it.
I wrote in my notebook, I hate Michael because he's always beating me up. And so I've decided I'm leaving. Michael found it and showed it to my mum. And she cussed me, and she beat me, and she sent me to my bed. The second time, I was 8.
She said to me, why do you have to go? Why can't you leave till tomorrow? I said, if I leave it till tomorrow, I'll never go.
Why couldn't you go back to your parents?
Well, for a number of reasons, my father and I didn't get on. You know, and he felt that because he'd brought me over here and I'd come to the age, and he felt that I should be able to look after myself. And he didn't want to claim any more responsibility.
How old were you then?
I was 19, 20.
I left school just over a year ago now, and I went straight into a job, and I was made redundant. And I've been unemployed now for 4 months.
Well, I just think that we should have something a bit more better to do than we're doing now. Anything really. Doesn't really matter what it is, as long as it's something to take our minds off the boredom of being unemployed.
Well, what we want is a workshop where we can work from to make ourselves self-employed to make money, and we can get off the dole. So that most people are not hanging around the streets all day long.
Why did you choose to come to London?
It's my sister stays down here. So I thought she'd have a flat, but she's not got one.
What else did you expect to find?
A job nearby. It's better than Glasgow. It's better than Glasgow now.
How much money did you have when you arrived?
£2.
Why do the people come here in the first place? Why do those boys come here in the first place?
Well, a lot of people get bored, you know, with their own homes and that, and they'll come up here, you know, expecting to see big lights and all the rest, you know. And West End to me is a dump. There's bugger all in the West End, you know.
You had an idea that there might be a bit of fun living rough in London.
Yeah, you know, if you do what you want, there was no sort of laws or anything. But it wasn't like that at all. It's really lonely.
I'd go down into the toilets as well and sit on the toilet, you know, and dress myself up like. But you see, the toilets were the only park and they're all small and all. And I always used to keep my eyes to the ground open, I'd find money and things like that, you know, because your belly, you know, you just have to survive, you have to learn to survive, that's all.
I think the council should make some sort of provision for people, young people, to either help them get a place, especially the young people who are not getting a great deal of money, you know.
Yeah. You're a little brown.
Fucking democracy, fire! Fucking democracy!
I can see the marks on his back ribs just like you can.
What about this distressing position on the official side, please?
The distressing situation on the official side is that people have to be treated in this way, and that we get forced into the position whereby we have to do this.
You feel you've been forced into this?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And one hates to be forced into this sort of situation. This is not pleasant. This is ugly.
And what about the people side of the coin?
They have a case as well. No question.
Our aim is to work with people who are mainly new to London, particularly the younger ones who are at risk in the West End. Basically, we give them a bed for the night, we give them 2 cooked meals, and advice on how to get whatever they've come to London for.
So they come in, you give them a meal?
Yeah. We talk to them. There's one worker on every night with a team of 5 or 6 volunteers. The workers rotate and the volunteers do the same night each week.
They're good, you know, they help you out in that if they can. You know, they'll sit and talk to you and ask you your problems and that, you know, and see if we can help you in any way.
What do you get out of volunteering at Centrepoint? Why does it appeal to you?
Meeting people, helping people.
whenever I can.
I suppose the reason I wanted to do something for homeless kids is because I feel there, but for the grace of God, go my kids.
Yeah.
And I would like to think that somebody would have done something to help them if they'd been in the same situation.
We're finding that we are giving kids very much a minimum of advice in a lot of cases. What we can do, of course, is get them off the streets for the night. The West End is not a very safe place for young kids. There's a lot of drugs, prostitution. We try and take them out of that before they get involved in it. And we can send them on to other projects that have got more time to give them advice. Our hostel has 12 beds. We see 3,000 kids. And if you start playing the numbers game, I think you just get so depressed you pack up and go home. So we try not to think about it, I suppose. It's appalling that our 10th anniversary is coming up next month, and we were set up as a stopgap measure 10 years ago, and nothing has been done. We're just seeing more and more and more people, and all the signs are that the statutory services will cut back and we will carry on seeing more and more people.
Why should that happen? And they're building luxury flats that are going to cost £3,000 a year. Right, who can afford that? They're going to have a big gate in the East End. That's what they're going to have, where we look over the wall like animals. And they're going to all look and have a good laugh at us. That's not right.
All right, they'll say it costs a bomb, we can't afford it. But what can they afford? When it come, I had to move from the top flat because the ceilings fell down twice for the rain. They told me we'll never be able to do that, we ain't got the money. You know what I mean? They still ain't done it now.
And we're talking about properties sometimes 50 years old that have never really had a proper modernisation.
That's a long while to be on your estate and have nothing done to your housing. I want the houses renovated properly.
This is what we're paying for. This is absolutely disgusting. The chute, the graffiti, the rubbish on the floor, the cracked windows. What else is there? This is not the way that we want to live. This is the way we're forced to live.
Do you live in Balham?
Yes.
What do you think of the place?
Oh, well, it's getting a bit dirty and neglected now. It did used to be very nice once upon a time.
I just couldn't go on with that picture. It was impossible. For my own sanity, I couldn't have done so, because this oppressiveness of the urban area was just too much.
And there's nowhere around there for you to go. All you've got is the park down there. And if it's raining, you're stuck indoors with the door shut, and that's it. All the children can do is look out the window.
I don't think I'd mind, first of all, but I just can't stand living in the tower block. If I had the chance to get out, I'd go, definitely.
People don't live in the country and have beautiful houses and things, they might as well see pretty pictures. And also to see pretty pictures without a sort of commercial bias, like not trying to sell something specific.
Having done murals, we are inclined to think that possibly galleries are the wrong place to show. They're in the wrong places and they're showing to the wrong people. And they're seen as possessions and not as communications. excitement that those people felt in the first place about the notion of demonstrating demolition being resisted by the people by pushing away JCBs and a bulldozer and rehabilitating their street and all having a happy time, children playing, somehow came again when there was an opportunity for them to join in the painting.
We believe that it is vital to involve the local community, for not for reasons that they'd benefit from it, but that they should have a say in what's going on.
That is not enough to make anyone cheerful. The people around you, I've got to be cheerful, they got to get down and do something to this place, you know. You can't put a bit of paint on the wall and say, well, you know, hope that it changes. People are in there and their attitudes have got to change.
The Lewisham Academy Music is a community youth music program where designed especially for young community people who are basically haven't got much money.
When you sign up for your membership, the good thing about it is that you're not set, you're not told, right, now you're a member, go out, buy yourself a manuscript book and a pen. Come here, sit down and learn these scales or read music. You know, you're allowed to come here, feel the instrument, play with it, and at the same time, you're going to learn.
The people that come in here, I say about 70% of them are on the dole. I mean, me and myself, I'm not on the dole now. I mean, I'm dead lucky. But when I was, this was the only place I could come to and find something to do, yeah? And inside myself, I felt like I was achieving something, yeah? It gave me hope. I could get up every day with a smile on my face, knowing I was actually going to go out there and do something. Even though I knew there wasn't a prospect of getting a job, at least I was doing something, yeah?
I was doing nothing until I found this place. You were lost. You could only go for a walk to the park and back, go around the shops, and that became the same old routine every day, every day, every day. It's no good. You're better to be doing something.
You can always mix with older people, but you don't always get the chance to mix with the younger people.
I've been into small nursing homes, and really it's terrible. They're sat round the room like a lot of zombies.
Well, because of the shortage of beds, there's a great pressure. Great danger that people will be pressured into going straight into a private nursing home, which I see as very frightening, because geriatric medicine is a very precise speciality.
And the attitude of people who run these homes, they are running them surely, purely for profit, and they will run them on a shoestring. The cheaper they can run them, the more profits they make. So the less staff they have, the more profits. It's cash in a till as far as they're concerned.
The real difficulty we have is that they don't have the kind of therapeutic environment they had in the hospital, which we have worked very hard to build it up such a long period and spend a lot of money on this.
It's a disgrace for them to ever think of closing hospitals. If it is in the paper the other day, that if Bethnal Green closes down Mildmaston, well, whoever's in charge, let them, please God, that they don't have to go to hospitals or their loved ones, and then they may have a bit of sympathy for other people.
The threat to Bethnal Green Hospital has become a symbol to EastEnders of a direct attack upon their fundamental needs and basic rights.
You know, what's going to happen if this casualty closes? I really don't know where the patients are not going to be able to get into hospital at all. They're going to have to stay at home when they're sick.
I mean, really, look at the factories around this. I mean, there's hundreds really in Bethnal Green alone. Yeah. I mean, they need that hospital. They really do need it.
If I could march, I'd march with them on their protest march.
You come down from Edinburgh as well?
Yes, I did.
So you came last night?
Yes, 10 o'clock bus.
So you're getting a bit tired now?
Exhausted, no shoes in my feet. I've walked them off.
Closures of hospitals and departments will lead directly to fewer jobs, longer waiting lists, and shorter stays in hospital. The burden of all this will fall mainly on the working women of this country. Because they're going to have to look after the sick, the old, the infirm, as well as the children. Our National Health Service is too precious to be butchered in this fashion.
The question would have to be asked, and I'm not sure they are these patients ever asked, do you wish to go into this nursing home or rest home?
Well,
because a lot of them haven't got any family at all. And I don't think they're asked. I think they are just told they're going.
The way that they judge you is superficial, to say the least, but the power they have to decide what happens to you in the short term or the long term is awesome.
Doctors tend not to see people as people, they see them as medical conditions.
I may not know exactly why my eyesight is like it is, but I think I know better than any specialist what it's like to see with my eyes.
The general view of deaf people is that they've got something that's got to be cured. They don't see it as a way of life. They say, oh, you're deaf. How can we solve the problem? How can we help this person to become like one of us?
The major charities obviously have a vested interest in portraying disabled people as pathetic victims of some kind of appalling tragedy, not least because it's the, unfortunately, the best way of raising their income and generating lots of money. A poster of an unfortunate disabled child with a kind of heart-rending caption on the end will quite clearly bring in more money than the poster of a stroppy disabled adult complaining to his local council about his lack of access or something.
The sort of picture that they convey of disabled people is that they're needy people, that they're people who are reliant on other people, unable to make decisions for themselves, and really sort of very vulnerable people.
Going shopping is such fun in sun, wind, rain and snow, because everyone's so kind to you wherever you chance to go. I bumped into a lamppost and a man kinder than most came up the street behind me saying, look out, mind the post. I love the general public, oh, they really are so kind. They tell you if you bump your head, especially when you're blind. Oh, going shopping is such fun in sun, wind, rain and snow, because everyone's so kind to you.
Didn't prepare you for the real world. You've cosseted and looked after and protected. And the real world comes as quite a shock when you get away from it.
The term special needs is used very frequently around segregated education, and I think it just masks what it really is, which is just taking away disabled children and putting them somewhere else. And I think the kind of education they receive reflects that, because a lot of what goes on in segregated education is around their physical or learning disabilities, rather than looking at what they need to learn to equip them to go out and do what it is they choose to do.
If a person is disabled, they are, as it says, disabled. Who's doing the disabling?
All the evidence, all the social indicators show that disabled people are second-class citizens. Now, there are only two ways you can explain that. One is that you can say disabled people as a group are totally inadequate, and that's why they end up as second-class citizens. Or you can say that society, not just in terms of individual attitudes, but through its institutionalized practices, discriminates systematically against a whole group of people.
Legislation is actually there, the 3% quota. What's happened is that the government have allowed large organizations, including their own, to exempt themselves.
The only way to change attitudes is to get people with disabilities in jobs and prove that a lot of the images and stereotypes are wrong. But to get a job, you've got to get rid of some of the images so it gets to be a vicious circle.
There are people in broadcast television who are making decisions about what is shot and what direction it's shot from, and then which bits are edited out and which bits are left in, so that they actually control the message that's made.
A bill will be brought forward to provide for a wider choice of broadcast services.
Choice has been one of the key words in the government's presentation of its broadcasting policy.
And it's up to us to put the minimum number of problems in the way of viewers and listeners getting the choice that they want.
Deregulation is portrayed as giving the television viewer more choice, when in fact the choice is choice amongst a number of very, very similar things.
If the government was serious, really serious about the business of putting listeners and viewers at the centre of broadcasting, why don't they create mechanisms so that we can have listeners and viewers on the board of directors of every broadcasting institution in this country?
In reality, it provides the framework for the Secretary of State, sympathetic to large media multinationals, to allow them to take over as much of the new system as they wish.
And it makes me mad. When I've been on a march, I've been on a rally, I've been on a picket line, and I've seen what have happened, and to see it reported in the papers the next day, completely different to what has happened, it makes my blood boil over. And I've quarrelled, I've done a lot of NUJ meetings, and I've quarrelled with a lot of them because I still believe that the media stinks.
Nobody gives a chance to the people who actually live there to talk about it, except when they're patronisingly interviewed by the people on television shows.
What we're saying is that, you know, enough's enough. You know, we want access to the airwaves. Ordinary people, as a democratic right.
It's all possible. The only way that it's not possible is when people moan about things but don't get nothing done.
Why don't we take the van over ourselves and make our own programmes? Shall we do that?
Yeah! The advantage of video is that when you interview people, you talk in the same language as them, and they can answer you in the language that they understand and you understand. Wherefore, if you had the BBC, for example, doing it, there'd be a BBC type filming them and asking them questions, and they would probably be a little bit afraid to come forward and express their opinions.
But the fundamental difference between our programmes and other social documentaries is that we give editorial control to the public. We actually give them control of the programme. That means that we're making programmes with people, not about people. And you get a different perspective, a different tone, a different texture coming from those programmes.
One of the main interests for us in trying to create something is to try and understand what it is that people are trying to express in their own lives, what their relationships signify. And in trying to understand them, we want to involve them. The value of intervening in the community and making a tape about them lies in, generally speaking, the way in which you can, as a group of people, use the facilities that you have, the resources that you have, the video or whatever, and you could be a street theatre group, whatever. It lies in the group's ability to be able to get to create a situation in which the community is able to reflect upon itself, upon its individuals, upon what it is doing, upon how it is operating, upon who is in the hierarchy of command, upon whether they have real power, and to get them to think about their own lot, their own time situation, just for a moment differently. That seems to me to be an important thing to be able to do.
In a few words, what is the contribution of the video, do you think, in this context?
I think it's something, well, it provides a focal point to start with, you know, because people were themselves going out into their own neighbourhood and sort of talking to people who they hadn't met before, often, or didn't know, about things which were the concern of both of them, you know, which gave an immediate personal note to the whole sort of question of interviewing and filming and so on.
You think it's important people should get together?
I do, really, yeah.
Why do you feel like that yourself?
Because I think people are getting worse now. They just go in and seem to shut their doors and they don't communicate anymore. you know.
Why are you prepared to do something yourself? Why are you prepared to be active like this?
I think to make it better for the children, really.
There's a knock on the door. Could it be the dinosaur?
You know, if we're all going to have like a community complex, we're all going to be laughing together, because it's nice to be able to laugh together, you know?
Yeah.
If you're going to laugh together, then some of the hostilities will slip.
People will learn. I mean, most of the trouble with the people do not know other people's ways of life. If people get together, they learn other people's ways of life up there, I think it can get people more together. We'll be right back.